to all you LLBN viewers, welcome. Hello, my name's Gary Schiller. I am VP for Technical Operations. Welcome to LLBN church service day. I'm just thinking about how long it's been since we first started this operation here. I was trying to think about some of the things that we did at the beginning, and it's been so long, it's actually been pretty fuzzy. But like I said, I hope tonight that you will have a blessing from this operation. There's a lot of people here that's done a lot of work, and I really appreciate it. I hope you will. Thank you very much.
Than my heart can believe. everything that he promised, and so much more, more than amazing, more than marvelous, more than miraculous could ever be. He's more than wonderful. That's what Jesus is to me.
Streets that are golden, and I Amen, amen, amen. What a blessing to be here tonight. I invite you all to pray with me. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful day. Wow, we are so blessed, Lord, to be here together to worship you, to praise you, and most importantly, Lord, to connect with you. We want to refuel from our long, crazy, stressful week. Lord, we need you. We need your strength. We need your freshly touch, your Holy Spirit to surround us. Lord, the Bible tells us that the joy of the Lord is my strength, it's our strength, Lord. We need that joy. We want that joy to replace all the bones that are hurting in our bodies, our minds, our souls, our hearts. Lord, we need you. We want you. And we run to you, Lord. This life, the pressure of this life brings us down. But Lord, you are our rock, our salvation, our fortress. And we know that we run to you, you're going to open your arms and welcome us and lift up our problems and give us the joy and the strength that only you can give us. Lord, we ask for the speaker of tonight. May you bless him and use him in amazing ways, Lord, so he can also contact, not only contact us, but so we can go out there and reach others and fill them with joy and that presence that only you can provide, Lord. Bless them. Bless each individual here today and bless the viewers. Thank you for your many blessings and thank you for giving us your joy and your strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, family and friends. The LLBN family is comprised of 8 channels and are run mostly by volunteers. And all of us here at LLBN are so passionate about spreading the love of Jesus Christ as far as we possibly can. However, we do depend on your donations to help run our operations, and we have a new building that is being built. And so please don't hesitate to send in your gifts of love, which we will absolutely appreciate, so that we can continue spreading the good news that Jesus is coming very soon throughout all the world. Thank you so much for being a part of the LLBN family.
Hi, boys and girls, how are you? It's your time, your story time again. Today, I'm going to tell you a story. Actually, I'm going to tell you 2 stories. The first story is about Timmy. Timmy doesn't like broccoli. He hates broccoli. But Mommy had a bowl of broccoli in front of him. He's broccoli. And he hated broccoli. But Mommy says, you don't get any ice cream unless you do your broccoli. And Timmy goes, and he had his long face. He didn't want his broccoli, and he just sat there. And Mommy says, you can't leave until you eat your broccoli, and just sat there. Everybody left the table, but he sat there. And sooner or later, nobody was there. So he propped up, he put a chair up, and he looked at the fridge, and from there, he saw his ice cream. His ice cream, wonderful, and he wanted his ice cream. And Mommy in the other room says, close the fridge door. I don't know how Mommy's does that, but all Mommies do that. And so he had to close the door and go back. He knew that he was good. He knew that the ice cream was there, but he knew that broccoli was good for him. But he didn't like broccoli. Why? Sometimes we have that conflict, right? We know something's good for us, but we don't want to take it because we have this other thing that's really good. It reminds me of a brother and sister. Their names are Amanda and Daryl. They're both doctors now, but when they were younger, they did something very, very special. Let's see what we can, let's roll the tape and see if we could see this. See that? They were world-class ice skaters. You know what it takes to be a world-class ice skater? You have to wake up 4 o'clock in the morning, and you go to the ice skating rink, and you would practice for 2 hours before the sun comes up. I didn't know that there was 2 4-o'clocks. I didn't know it happened twice, but they did. And then they would go to school. After school, they would have ballet lessons, and another 2 hours, they have 4 hours to 6 hours a day to practice and practice. Sometimes they did, oh man, I don't want to practice. My body is tired. I don't want to practice anymore. But they know that the reward is at the end. They could go to world championship and perform for the world. That's what it means. So back to our broccoli story. So mommy knew that Timmy liked ice cream, but he had to eat his broccoli first. So what does mommy do? Mommy goes up, takes ice cream cone. He picks out his ice cream cone, and then he puts the ice cream in the ice cream cone, and guess what happens? Puts the ice cream in there, and then he puts the broccoli on top of the ice cream and says, here is your ice cream. You have to eat your broccoli first before you get your ice cream. It is important to know, children, that we need to work hard and do things, and then we get our reward. Our reward does not come after our, before our work. Back to you. Thank you.
Today's scripture reading is found in Romans 7, verses 14 through 25. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. But what I hate, that I do. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do, but the evil I will not to do, that I practice. Now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. But I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh of the law of sin.
Joseph was a little boy. He was driven by his dreams. God spoke to him, told him he had chosen him. But when others didn't understand, Joseph still believed and trusted him. Trusted and was willing to dream on. When the world just doesn't believe, God has promised never to leave him alone. there's no valley deep enough that he can lead you through. He'll walk with you, walk the roughest roads with you. No mountain ever rose so high that you can climb with him. And stand up tall, stand and look down on it all. Dream on. When the world just doesn't believe, God has promised never to leave you alone. Dream on. Follow hope wherever it leads, for in the seed of dreams there is promise from the dawn. Then listen for the music, keep on following the star. Morning can be far. Then listen for the music, keep on following the star. Morning can be far. Dream on. Dream on.
Wow. Thank you to all of our participants for just elevating us into the very presence of God, right? I'm so excited to be here and happy to announce that we've actually relocated. And so now Southern California is our home. We're excited about that. We just recently purchased a home, only to discover that, come to find out, we're not the only residents on the lot. There's a big hedge that borders our property, and I hear a lot of activity going on in the bushes and in the ground. Come to find out, we have an infestation of rats. I hate rats. Just looking at a rat makes my stomach do somersaults. I hate rats. And so I've asked some of the locals around here, so what do you do to get rid of rats? And many of them have said, well, the best thing is to get rattlesnakes, and that will take care of your rats. And the only thing I hate more than rats is rattlesnakes. So we're getting used to Southern California. So far, we love it, other than the rats and the rattlesnakes. So thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you for the incredible music. And as we open God's word together, let's just pause once again and ask God's Spirit to be here with us. Father, it is a crazy world right now, with the elections coming up and a lot of questions and the division in our country and this virus that is just ravaging the world, Father. Then we read of reports of hurricanes and earthquakes and fires raging all around. God, for just a few moments, please, would you help us hit the pause button? Quiet the clamor that clutters our souls, that we might revel in your presence as we consider your word. God, teach us, and may we experience in your presence a Sabbath shalom. In the name of Jesus. Hanley Page, an aviation pioneer back in the days of World War I. He was on a solo flight mission, an empty cargo plane cruising at about 10,000 feet, when suddenly he knew he was in trouble. he was very, very disturbed. Because there, loose in the cockpit, he saw a rat. Did I mention how much I dislike rats? He tried to put it out of his mind, but he couldn't. He tried convincing himself that it was no big deal, but he couldn't help watch this rat scampering back to the back of the cargo plane, and he noticed the rodent started to chew on the hydraulic lines, which of course would impact the landing gear. Hanley Page figured this was probably his last flight. What could he do? This was before autopilot technology. He didn't have a co-captain. He was all by himself. He had no good options. What to do? Oh, we'll suspend the story there. And if there is time at the end, I'll share the rest of the story. For now, I invite you to turn in your Bible to the book of Romans. When I asked Pastor Dan, so what do you want me to preach about tonight? He said, just the gospel. Pure and simple, preach the gospel. So my mind immediately went back a couple of years ago at church in Kettering, Ohio. We did a 26-week sermon series on the book of Romans. And I would argue, if there is the consummate declaration of the gospel in Scripture, I would point to the book of Romans. It really was a life-transforming journey, week after week, to just expose our hearts to the gospel, the pure and simple gospel. And so the challenge, of course, is how do I compress 26 sermons into this one? Like I said, we may not get back to Hanley Page up at 10,000 feet. Got a lot of ground to cover. And then I thought, well, maybe we go right to the heart of Romans. In the first six chapters or so, Paul unpacks these grand themes of assurance of salvation and righteousness and justification in Christ alone. It's beautiful presentation of the gospel. But then you get to chapter 7, and the apostle pivots, and suddenly his letter to the followers of Christ in Rome, it becomes very personal, and it becomes very practical. So I want to jump right there. Consider his words, Romans chapter 7. I hope you have a Bible. We begin in verse 14, where Paul writes, "We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave." It's as if Paul is explaining, look, the human race, all of us, we have a problem. You might think of it as a rat. And leading up to this, Paul makes it clear that, look, the rat is not the law. Prior to this, he calls the law righteous and holy and good. Here he reminds us that the law is spiritual. I like Romans chapter 3, verse 20 in the J.B. Phillips translation, where it says, "The straight edge of the law simply shows us how crooked we all are." The rat is not the law. That's not the problem. The problem is sin. That's the rat. And then Paul opens a window to his soul, and he exposes his own personal struggle. And I'm so thankful that he did, because as you're reading through the book of Romans and reading about the gospel, you begin to wonder, am I the only one who has this glaring disparity in my own life between the gospel and then how I actually live? And so Paul says this, I do not understand what I do. For what I do, I do not want to do. And if I do what I do not want to do, then we agree that the law is good. As it is no longer myself who do it, but it is the sin living in me. Notice that phrase. It is the sin living in me. That's the problem. And of course, we can all resonate with this struggle, can't we? Kids want to go to Chuck E. Cheese. And I remind myself, no, I'm not going to Chuck E. Cheese. Are you kidding? This body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. I'm not going to feed it with junk. No way. And then I think, well, maybe I'll go and I'll just order a small salad with the dressing on the side. But no sooner do I get to the pizza joint and I am wolfing down a large pizza with extra cheese and I wonder, why do I do this? I know better. Look what this pizza did to Chuck E. Cheese. He's not a svelte little rodent, right? He is an obese rat. Why do I eat what I don't want to eat? Why do I do what I can't seem to do what I really want to do? And then Paul, as if for good measure, goes on and basically repeats the paragraph and the struggle. He says, "For I know that good itself does not dwell in me." That is, in my sinful nature. That's our nature. "For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I just keep on doing." Now, if I do what I do not want to do, and here's the statement again, "It is no longer I who do it, but it is the sin living in me." It's that rat gnawing away on my soul. It's the sin living in me. I cannot read this verse in Romans without thinking of a story that my friend and colleague for many years on a pastoral staff, Pastor Alex, shared of an encounter she had with her son, Nico. At the time, he was about 10 years old. She told me how he left his Nerf toys in the middle of the family room, and she was trying to pick up the house and get prepared for company coming that weekend. And so she decided to just pick up all of the toys and throw them in the trash can in the laundry room. It wasn't until later that afternoon that she casually mentioned to Nico, "Oh, by the way, you left all of your toys in the family room, and so I put them away for you." "Well, what did you do with them, Mom?" "I threw them in the trash." "No! Oh, this was so upsetting to the kid." He said, "Mom, how could you do that?" And he raced to the trash can. Fortunately, the toys were still there. And of course, Mom wanted to use this as a teaching moment. And she said, "Nico, understand. If I have to pick up after you, then next time, I may not tell you what I did with the toys. I may just throw them out for good. So you need to pick up after yourself." But then Nico kind of went on the offensive. He said, but Mom, I didn't leave the toys there." "What? What are you talking about?" Alex said, "I know your dad didn't leave your toys there. I know your sister didn't do it. I know I didn't do it. What are you talking about?" But he decided to just double down on his defense. "Mom, I didn't do it. It wasn't me." And she said, wait a minute, Nico. You're telling me that, like a burglar broke into the house and put your toys in the middle of the family room? What are you talking about? It wasn't you." And then he said, "It wasn't me, Mom. It was the sin living inside me." Touchdown, Nico. I love that. It's actually good theology. He's just echoing the words of the Apostle Paul. And of course, his mom, who is a pastor, how could she argue with that, right? "It's not me," Paul says. "It is this rat, this sin that is living in me. So, verse 21, I find this law at work. Although I want to do good. Again, it's like he repeats himself now a third time. Evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work in me. And then he exclaims, "What a wretched man I am." Have we not all made such a declaration? What a wretched sinner I am. Why do I do this? And why can't I do what I really want to do? Then Paul asks a very practical question. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? What am I going to do? Who will rescue me? And now, where Paul has been very personal, here he gets very practical. He declares, "Thanks be to God, who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord." Thanks be to God who delivers me from the rat of sin that is destroying me from the inside out. See, understand, my friend, you do not have in your own power the ability to take on that rat of sin. You and I, we need help. We need to be delivered. And so Paul exclaims, "Thanks be to God who delivers us." See, it is not our job to muster up more willpower to perfectly obey all the laws. This can be so frustrating and debilitating in the spiritual walk. When we try so hard to keep all of the laws, to do what we know we want to do. See, that's not really our job. Our job is to abide in Christ, and to invite Christ to abide in us. In other words, to live in this space of surrender, to live moment by moment, day by day, yielded to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Spiritual life is not about trying real hard to be good. It's not even just about doing the spiritual disciplines and training. Ultimately, the spiritual life is all about trusting that He will deliver us, that God can change our very desires, that God can transform my human heart. You know, a lot of people approach spiritual life as if they're living in this little house on a huge prairie. And in the prairie, you have millions and millions and millions of rats. Let's just keep the motif of rats going, shall we? You might try to go after all of these rats, all of these sins in your life, setting all kinds of traps, but you're never going to catch them all. And it's just a recipe for feeling defeated and exhausted every time. Or people sometimes take the approach in spiritual life, well, I know all of these rats that live within me, and I know all of my issues and my problems and my sins, but maybe if I can just keep them underground, at least I will appear to be holy. And so you can go through the acres of prairie with a canoe paddle and bat down every rat. And some people approach spiritual life like, if I can just keep pride and lust and gluttony and all of these things that I struggle with under the surface, then at least I'll look holy. And again, it's just paralyzing. You'll never be good enough. Inevitably, you sing the song of Paul, why do I do what I don't want to do? It's so frustrating. There is a quote from an old booklet called Victory in Christ that has just been so helpful in my own understanding. And I think when we start getting this concept, you go really deep with God. It's written by W.W. Prescott, first president of Walla Walla University. Listen to what he writes. For a long time, I tried to obtain victory over sin, and I failed. I have since discovered the reason. Oh, he has my attention, because that's my story. For a long time, I try to overcome sin. I try to kill all of those rats in my life. I've tried. And I just keep failing. But here, Prescott says, I've now discovered why. Instead of doing the part which God expects me to do and which I can do and which he cannot do for me, I was trying to do God's part, which he does not expect me to do and which I cannot do and which he has promised to do for me. Did you catch that? That's so true. For years, I kept trying to do good, and I just couldn't do it. And now I'm beginning to understand the problem. Here it is. I keep trying to do what only God can do, and that I cannot do for myself. That is to, through willpower, through gritting my teeth and clenching my fists and trying a little harder, to eradicate all of these rats, all of these sins in my life. I can't do it. I need outside help. But see, I keep trying to do that instead of focusing on the one thing that God cannot do for me and that only I can do for myself, which is what? Surrender. To live moment by moment in this posture of constantly being yielded to the promptings and the will of the Holy Spirit. To yielding my will and saying, God, I surrender in this moment. And then only God can change my desires, my heart, and transform me from the inside out. When I first read that quote, I reflected in my journal and I wrote this. If anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. I have been trying harder to be a new creation than I have been trying to be in Christ. Don't fight sin, find Christ. The most important principle of spiritual life that I know, there it is. Don't focus on sin. Focus on finding Christ. Our battle is not to stop sinning. Our battle is to keep trusting. See, our focus is not to abolish all of our bad behaviors. Our focus must always be to abide in Christ. Otherwise, spiritual life becomes just sort of this frustrating attempt at behavior modification. And that's how Christ said to us, abide in me, and I will abide in you. And you remember the promise. He says, if you abide in me, I will abide in you, and you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, he says, you can do what? you can do nothing. Now, Jesus does not say, abide in me so that you can produce a lot of fruit and good works and overcoming sin. He doesn't say produce. He says bearing much fruit. You will bear much fruit. But apart from Christ living in us, you can do nothing. Friends, the answer is never to try to chase down the rat. You fight the rat of sin and you are going to crash. So let's go back to Hanley Page, shall we? You remember him? Stuck at 10,000 feet on a solo test mission with a rat chewing into the hydraulic lines. What is the guy to do? In that moment, he remembered an obscure lecture way back when he was in a high school science class. And he remembered the teacher explaining how rats actually need more oxygen in order to survive than humans do. And so rather than leaving the controls and chasing the rat all over the airplane, he simply pulled back on the yoke and climbed higher and higher and higher. When he landed safely, he went to the back of the cargo area, and there he found a dead rat lying by the hydraulic lines. The answer is never to chase down the rat. You're going to crash if you chase the rat. The answer is always to climb higher and higher and higher into the presence of God. Live in His presence. How? Eat every day of the daily bread, the bread of life. Drink of the living water. Abide in Jesus. Trust Him to reprogram your heart and your mind and to transform your desires. Let the presence of God change your heart so that you can live in such a way where sin is not always gnawing at you. And someday we're going to turn around and we will see a dead rat just lying there. Because that rat no longer has control in our lives. So don't chase the rat. Climb higher. And keep climbing. Higher. And higher. And higher. Into the presence of Jesus. Keep climbing toward heaven until that great day when we will fly through the gates of glory. And on that day, we will be in the presence of God forever and ever. Amen. We have two natures, sin and holiness. They war for supremacy of our soul. Which one prevails? The nature that you nurture. So, nurture your friendship with Jesus, and He will deliver you from the enemy.
For the price you pay, bearing all my
again, thank you. Wow. I don't know about you, but this is like the first time, I think, in 9 months where there's been even a hint of worshiping together. And I got to tell you, my soul is just hungry for gathering, even though we are a small group. And so I'm very, very grateful for the ministry of LLBN in this community and really all around the world that puts together programming like this. When we find ourselves in the middle of a pandemic, we can still worship together. So I'm very grateful. Thank you for joining us tonight. What a blessing to just enjoy the worship and the music, to explore together God's Word, and to talk about the gospel. So let me pray for you wherever you're at. Father in heaven, tonight we just worship you and we thank you for your goodness in our lives. Father, thank you for the gospel that reminds us that we will never be good enough. And no matter how hard we try, we will never willpower our way to heaven, that it is all about Jesus. For your goodness and your grace in our lives, we are profoundly grateful. And God, I pray now for the power of every viewer, every person here in this small circle. May you live in us and may your kingdom flow through us. And may the gospel be real in the way we treat one another and the way we live and the way we worship in the name of Jesus. Amen.